It's Gwen Joliet of Joliet Street, Manchester. Mr. Covington, I just had a bowel movement in my britches, and I'll never forgive you for that.
Wow!
Christ can't see, Christ can't see, he's well, but it's and clean. He's blessed with an apple that stepped out of my tree. Oh, wow! Christ can't see, Christ can't see,
blood like a dream, a kettle that whistles and steams, posts that and whine, you're 18. You write beautifully and you're mine, oh my. You're my acolyte, I'm your lech. We fell in thrall the night we did sex. Sent you a pic of my. You came back with a smiley face, and now we've caught from all over the place. You stepped out of my wet dreams and into my Hitler-sized heart. Now you're my acolyte divine. You're 18. You write beautifully, and you're mine, all mine. Wow, they sure put up a fight, threatened to sue. Oh, how they kvetched, but short story long, their crybaby act got the gone.
Jeez, I tell you, that Ricky Garbage, he has so much talent. I just burn with jealousy. Is my head burning brightly red? Hi, welcome to Ward 13. We have Kathy Corkery, who of the Sierra Club from New Hampshire. She is on the phone because. How are you feeling, Kathy?
Oh, I'm feeling much better. Thank you so much.
Well, you know.
How are you?
Well, I'm fine, but you know, you have my sympathy. You know, lobbying up in Concord can be a nauseating experience.
It definitely feels dirty sometimes, I will admit that.
So you wear the orange tag of a lobbyist, and you're one of the good guys. How is it with the change in party up there?
Oh, it is very different, very different. We have had a lot of really good discussions about making changes that will help consumers and help ratepayers and get some action on climate. It's it the conversations have been creative and interesting and solutions-based. They are not, denying climate change or denying science. They are welcoming and they want to have some solutions.
You know,
it's been very refreshing.
I'm thinking about the state senate. My friend Donna Susie is now the president of the senate, and is that what are she is president? Because there's a couple of positions up there, and I know that she represents my family's, my father's former hometown, well, it is his home, was his hometown, of Litchfield, which I'm still involved with. And, of course, they've had the problem, Litchfield, Merrimack, and I think Londonderry, with the plastics that were dropped into the river, destroying the aquifer or poisoning the aquifer and their wells. And I would think that her now being the president would be a positive thing for trying to help get some equity and something going.
There are a number of bills addressing what they call PFAS, P-F-A-S, pollution. And in the Merrimack Valley, it has come from manufacturing. There's a company, an international company, a foreign company called Saint Gobain in Merrimack, as you noted.
Right.
I think they make material that has fire retardant qualities and water retardant qualities. That come from our friends at DuPont and 3M. Those are the companies that made Teflon and Gore-Tex and these other materials that actually are not good for people.
You mean drinking plastic is bad for me, to absorb plastic through water?
Yeah, not so good.
Who'd have thunk it,
even through a plastic straw, not a really good thing.
The Atlantic talked about the plastic straw, basically, and I remember as a kid, but I'd forgotten about it, straws were made out of paper. But once you got that type of, the fast food industry explodes and you got that type of plastic lid, you have to be able to push through it, and you can't do that. And the unnecessary pollution of plastic straws, and I never even thought about it. It's so bad that, you know, Joe Kelly Lavasser was saying, we don't need plastic straws, which is true.
Oh, he supports that?
Well, you know, that was that day, Kathy.
No. Okay. Well,
I'm waiting the cycle another year, and Joel will be my friend again.
I ask because there is a bill, another bill that just passed the House Commerce Committee that would ban the use of free distribution of plastic straws in New Hampshire.
Oh, my God, that sounds like communism. That sounds like something. It was, something like that made Clint Eastwood the mayor of one of my hometowns, Carmel by the Sea. I think that was ice cream. But I remember Berkeley banned foam cups because they used a certain thing. And everybody, you go out there, you're coming. I lived in Cambridge thinking, geez, this place is more left-wing than Cambridge, Mass. But they were actually right. That was such a destructive type of...
It is. It's really... There are two statewide restriction bills. One is for plastic straws.
Yeah.
And the other is for the free distribution of those plastic bags with handles.
Right.
So when you go to the grocery store, all, you know, the 20 plastic bags that the kid puts all your food in.
Hey, I use them as garbage bags.
And, you know, thank you for reusing them. And it's not, that's a great reuse of them. But what we really need to do is step one. And step one is reduce. We've got to reduce all of those plastic bags. They're gumming up the systems at the transfer stations, and they're just filling up truckloads upon truckloads of trash.
Yeah.
We need something else. I'm really excited by these two bills.
The K cups, too. Keurig cups. I don't use.
Oh, yeah.
I don't have a system because I figure, you know, I can make coffee my own in a four pot coffee maker. And there's this incredible invention I've heard of is the microwave. You know, you can turn off your coffee. It gets cold, and you can heat it up again in the microwave, which is probably, you know, how old fashioned can you get, right? But I was just realizing the incredible pollution they're causing, and it's so unnecessary.
Yeah, yeah.
People don't even think of
there. Yeah, and there's a lot of these convenience items that are really just not necessary, and they are creating a lot, way too much trash, and we've got to address that.
Well, I was reading in the National Review, you know, which Bill Buckley created, that, you know, what recycling, who needs it? It's economically unfeasible. And I'm thinking, what is that about? But then I realized that's where I found an article attacking you guys. It was an ad, you know, an advertorial by the natural gas industry, you know.
Oh, so, I missed that one.
Yeah, it's like one of those, or it was probably just something on the site. It wasn't, but advertorials. Because plastic bags are made out of oil, aren't they? Petroleum.
Yes, fossil fuels.
Polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. And now a lot of people can't use their wells in Litchfield, but there was all this debate over what is the level where it's contaminated and not. And I guess in New Hampshire, under the last regime, it was much higher than in other states.
Right. Well, it's what they call an emergent pollutant. It is one of those things that wasn't tested before it went on the market.
Yeah.
And we had no idea what it would do to our bodies before they released it into the wild, if you will.
Right.
And so now, only now, and it's been out since after World War II, and it's everywhere. Like everybody,
it's in everybody's body too.
Has it? Everybody on this earth has some trace of this DuPont chemical. When you think about that, that is mind-boggling.
Well, you know, it's evolution. You know, the people that they can't take plastic, they'll all die off. Except they don't seem to be doing that, do they? But that's another show. That's another show.
That's a long talk. But we are sponsoring with a couple other groups a movie called The Devil We Know. And it's about the DuPont and 3M chemical. And the really big, there is a civil action suit in West Virginia.
West Virginia?
Yeah, West Virginia on the Ohio River.
Banjo music here.
Yeah.
I've been there many times.
It's a really significant case because they won. And they did testing of blood and urine tests of people in the area, and we're able to create a database of different levels and different medical conditions. And this movie, I don't have anything around Manchester, but gosh darn it, if somebody wants to see this movie at the Manchester Library or something, give John a call. Give the station a call and let us know. We'll bring it to Manchester.
Call Rich Gerard. Call Rich Gerard's show.
It's an important movie.
I'm sure it is.
Explains well.
Is this the movie with Burt Reynolds and the Hillbillies?
No. What's that, Burt Reynolds?
Well, I thought, Burt Reynolds is from Florida. But let's get into the EPA. You know, when I tell people like Matt Connerton that I played in the Piscataqua River, not the Piscataqua, it's Piscataqua, right? The one in Portsmouth.
Right.
How could I forget? That's my child. That's the river. The Piscataqua River in human feces and toilet paper and that. He looks at me like I'm shocked, saying, how could you do that? I said, we were kids and there was no EPA. It was the 1960s. Right. I mean, you played down there. You couldn't. If you caught the fish, you had to throw them back. And people under my age don't know what it's like to have not had the EPA. They don't understand what rolling back the EPA and environmental controls will do.
Yeah, well, they will soon. Because now the new, after Pruitt, Scott Pruitt was basically asked to take a hike, because he was so controversial
and corrupt,
spending our taxpayer dollars for trips to Europe and whatnot. They replaced him with a former coal company lobbyist.
That sounds
his name's Andrew Wheeler.
But let's be fair, when you guys were on talking about Monsanto, Obama put a Monsanto lobbyist.
It's true. But I guess the difference is that this is the head guy.
Right. The other guy just handled.
The one agency that's supposed to protect our public health in these regulations. And the first thing that he announced when he was still acting acting administrator, he would roll back mercury standards for power plants.
Yeah, mercury is so good with people, you know.
I know.
It's like,
it's really great on sushi.
They ought to, I remember when the swordfish had the... we had swordfish on Fridays, and then suddenly it's gone for a decade or a generation. It was so adulterated with mercury for some reason.
Right.
Yeah. If the regulation's not there, I guess the problem isn't there, right?
Right. If we ignore it, it'll go away.
Yeah, what collusion, you know? There are some very nice people that are polluters, Kathy. Very fine people. Very fine people are polluters.
On both sides.
Yeah, they have memberships at Mar-a-Lago.
But, so I heard.
My God, I remember, because my family was General Motors, my stepmother. And, you know, when you're out in Michigan, and then Ontario is part of, General Motors, too. And the lakes that were destroyed, I'm just thinking, I'm out there, the lakes were dying because it was such a beautiful place, fishing, hunting, and the emissions from the power plants, coal-fired power plants, destroyed the lakes. They were acidic. And they were dying. This isn't even to mention like Cleveland when the river goes on fire, That's like the 1970.
Right?
I mean.
Yeah, I mean, when we think about Merrimack, the Merrimack River, and all the PFAS that's been dumped into it, That's people's drinking water.
Well, they used to dump dyes into it, blood, guts. It used to be disgusting. Well, the Elliott Hospital has its new place. That was the slaughterhouse.
Oh,
ew. Yeah, they just dumped it. It was an open sewer, you know?
Yeah.
But look at...
Absolutely.
I hear that the... And I'll say it, the Republican, because it seems to be that party. And, of course, my party, they're always selling out, too. We won't get into that. So it's a bipartisan effort that there's another assault on the Clean Water Act, you know, even after what happens in Flint, Michigan, and you know.
Yep. And that these communities are just being ignored. It's really a sad state of affairs, and it's exactly the opposite of what the EPA was supposed to do.
Right, and one can only imagine that there must have been some change in the tort law through that wonderful tort law reform, because they always say, oh, this person dropped a cup of coffee on her lap and got $1 million from McDonald's. Not telling you that the judge later turned it into $50,000. And they use ambulance chases for tort reform. They don't tell you that torts are an essential part of our system because, like a Superfund site, which that's disappeared from, I don't ever hear about Superfund sites. You know, the litigation to enforce laws, because laws are there, but they have to be enforced. And many times you have to sue. And if you have unfriendly judges or slight changes to laws, you no longer, when there's no longer the threat of the economic loss, you know, they'll pollute like hell.
Yeah, and that's what we're seeing with the Saint-Gobain. So the state of New Hampshire is going through the motions to create a safe drinking water standard for the PFAS, and there's a whole category of those chemicals, and they are asking for public comment and what have you, and they've had a couple of meetings so far, some public meetings, and you know, the first meeting was last week, and it was like at 1:30 over at DES, and you know who was there.
I can imagine.
All these lobbyists, they don't have to wear an orange badge.
When they testify?
There.
They don't have to wear?
Not in the rulemaking process, because it's not legislation. It's an administrative.
Oh, Elizabeth Ropp, you know. Has told me all about the rulemaking process. Like, you know, she gets that bill through, Sununu signs it, and it was only recently, like over a year later. I don't even know. We'll have to ask. Elizabeth Rupp, she's got an article for the folks in Manchester, in Manchester Inkling today, and you can check it out. She can't be here because she works on Tuesdays. I think she took the shift so she doesn't have to come on my show, Kathy.
Oh, no, that's not true.
I know it's true, you know, and I'm going to investigate.
Well, the rulemaking process, I'm happy to tell people about that. It goes on until April 15th. And if folks want to learn more about that, I should have sent you a link to it, but I'm sorry, I've been so like with this cold.
I'll ask Matt Connerton. We can bring it up on his show, and maybe you can call in.
Okay. Yeah.
When you're feeling
yeah.
better, he's a better I'm interviewer than I. You know.
Oh, I didn't.
Well, at this time of year, because, you know, with the cold air, he doesn't have the problem with fleas. You know he's a Yeti, American. Oh, gee. Well, you know.
I did not know that.
Oh.
Where have I been?
You need to bring it, come on, and bring your kazoo.
I've got it here somewhere. I probably shouldn't use it because I got a cold.
I couldn't find my kazoo, and Ricky Garbage, you know, who's a nickname for a flower shop maven, He's just inspiring me to write music, you know, that kazoo.
Oh. I've got to get a kazoo in your hand.
Yes, and the orange kazoo.
Oh, let's see if I have one of those.
Hey, I know you say you don't want to talk about Babe Ruth's daughter, but so let's talk a little bit. How are the presidential candidates that you've met? I don't, you know, because of the Green New Deal, are they talking about the environment?
Well, we're still trying to figure out how we're going to talk about them.
Right.
So I'm really excited that there's so many of them. I will say that. And,
oh, it's like Connerton, like on a hot August, you know, when the windows are closed and everything, you know, swarming, fleas, oh, midges, like what they call in Bedford, though, or is that England? Can't remember. I've never seen so many presidential candidates. It's like the midges in Bath, England, you know, these tiny little bugs that are, they harass you and haunt you. You don't see that in those, you don't see those in those masterpiece theater movies, you know, the horse, you don't hear the horse farting and all the other stuff. Everything's so nice.
It's not highbrow enough, is it?
No, but yet, horses cause pollution too.
Well, did you see the movie The Favorite?
No, I don't. I am of English stock, related to Harry and Edward, you know, through a Norman knight of 1230, through the Spencer family, their mother. And that doesn't mean I have to watch the stuff. What happens in the movie?
It is not at all factual. Let's just be clear about that.
What historical movie is? What's it about?
Right. It's about
Babe Ruth.
It's not about baseball. It's not, and I know a lot of people thought it was.
Yeah.
I know, but it is about a queen.
Queen Mary.
No. I think it was an Anne, but again, made up stuff.
Queen Anne was a Protestant.
Yeah, the inner workings of her council and the favoritism that she chose and maybe not so wisely chose.
Yeah.
It was very silly. But one of them, the woman there,
with the big Popeyes, the gal with the Popeyes that played Billie Jean King.
Yes, her.
I saw that movie with Roppy. I can't remember her name though. I call her Popeye. Oh, Emma Stone.
Emma Stone. That's right. She in a carriage ride.
Oh my God!
She gets assaulted by one of the other riders, and then when she goes to dismount the carriage, they kick her off, and she lands flat into the mud and reminded me of those bugs that you were talking about.
Well, listen to this. I'm shocked on two things. They say, you know, and I got my VA glasses on, so I might be getting the name right. It says, Mark Gatsis portrayed John Churchill. I'm related to the Churchill family because they're Spencers. They're part of the Spencer family.
Oh, and, right.
And all the trouble I had with Mayor Gatsis, and look, at one of his relatives is playing one of my relatives. Folks, can't we all get along?
Can't we just get along?
It's Mark Gatsis. Well, that's disappointing.
Oh, well.
I'll have to go see it now that my relatives are in it, even if they were. I don't like the Churchills. Fascists.
Yeah. Well, right. And but the fun part is that it's all make-believe.
It's a
true story.
Oh, yeah. This movie is based on a true story. Right. Hey, you know, I've got a...
Or truly a story.
I've got a great script. It's about the time in the 1984 election where the Manson girls, posing as anti-sex activists for Nancy Reagan's group, came to Milford and kidnapped the president. Yeah, little known incident. But because basically, they just replaced him with another actor who was better, and you know, life goes on.
The rest is history.
Yes, I got to get that permit to film at the Oval soon. Paul, that would be with that.
You should do a reenactment for your show.
Oh, you know, movies are better than real life, don't you think?
Yes.
Paul, we're going to have that guy that was running around with his pot belly and in his undies as Ronald Reagan. It should be a blockbuster, huh?
We'll make lots of money with that.
Oh, well, I you know, I don't live for money. If I did, I'd probably get sued even more than I do now. Well, if we can wrap up before we get, because Mr. Baseball hopefully will be coming on. In the next, what is the big priority of once you get over this cold of Sierra Club, New Hampshire?
Mm-hmm. I think going into April.
Yep.
We are looking at the second half of the legislative session.
Yep.
And I'm very excited about that. I think we're going to make some real progress to protect our environment and protect our public health. And we'll be getting into, we've got, oh my gosh, what is it? We're doing a program for outings this summer, like we have never done before.
You mean like picnics and stuff. You're not going to like out Ted Gatzis for being like, you know, a closet restorationist from the time of Queen Anne?
No. Going fishing. You said you like the Piscataquag.
Piscataquag. I don't think, we can go catch a big salmon down there. They used to have salmon in the olden days.
Probably not salmon. We'll probably get a good bass. I've caught some trout over there in New Boston.
Yeah. I was surprised that they've all come back. You know, it's gone 32 years. You couldn't get a trout around here.
Oh, my gosh.
You got what called suckers.
No.
Horn pout, which is a catfish.
Yeah.
And eels.
Yep. And they've got maybe closer where the water is deeper, you'll get some bigger fish up that way.
Oh.
But we want to do some fishing this summer, we've got a new hiking volunteer that we are planning for at least one hike a month. So, and we want to do like urban hiking as well in Manchester. Now that you've got those new
trails,
greenways, the trails.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it'd be fun. Would you go on a walk?
Oh, I am the 20. You'll ask me in about a month.
Okay. I'm on that. I will ask you in a month or two.
I got my cane here. It's time for some baseball, Kathy. But I'll contact you. We'll get you on the Mac Covington's show or whatever the heck his name is, and we'll talk about. Yeah. It's good hearing from you.
I'm happy to do it.
Hope to get
you
in here in person in the future with your kazoos.
Excellent. Thank you so much. You take care.
Okay, you too. Take care. I'll talk to you in a little while. Bye.
Okay.
Okay, Paul, can we run that intro Hopefully, you're and I'm going to call Mr. Baseball. Of a joke Governor Ronald Reagan used to tell. He used to tell a joke about Dr. Kildare and Ben Casey coming out of the hospital. And of course, they're very competitive. And Dr. Kildare spots an owl in a nest in a tree. So they challenge each other. They climb up the tree, and Dr. Kildare performs a vasectomy on the owl. And Dr. Casey, the brain surgeon, if you remember, so he says, that's nothing. So he takes out the owl's tonsils, and then they leave. And Dutch Reagan always got the guffaws when he said, he got to the punchline. When a couple weeks later, the owl's complaining. He says, ever since those two guys in the white coat came up to the nest, I can't hoot worth and I can't worth a hoot. Well, Mr. Baseball, I just laid the S-bomb. I don't know if Paul Cormier, our great engineer, got that, but what can you do? My cane fell.
You didn't get it on the air.
Oh, okay. As Goody and Thunderbolt and Lightfoot. How are you, Mr. Baseball?
I'm doing well. I'm recuperating very quickly.
Oh, wait until you see. Oh, what a great effect. I've got you in the center of a baseball on both sides of me, and with my bald head, ooh, I'm getting chills. So go.
I still have some hair.
Wouldn't have noticed unless you pointed out. Now that you pointed it out, it looks sensational.
It does. Oh, hello, Mr. Baseball. Be happy you're not here with us tonight.
It's the greatest thing ever.
No, the thing with when we had Casey Stengel butting in on Jim O'Connell.
Actually, okay. This is the second greatest thing.
Mr. Baseball, you'll have to see this to believe it. All right, Mr. Baseball, we're going through like in the old days, the radio. We'll forget the visuals. Babe Ruth's daughter died. And that was a great milestone. What did you think when she died, Julia Ruth?
I met her about 8, 9, 10 years ago when I bought her book.
You did?
In Conway.
Right.
She signed.
She lived in New Hampshire for many years.
I wasn't a big fan of hers because she was always pulling for the Red Sox against the Yankees.
Mr. Baseball.
Yeah, well, that's her prerogative.
But about her father? You weren't thrilled to meet the Babe's daughter.
What about the Babe's daughter?
Weren't you thrilled to meet her?
Yeah, it was interesting. She was very businesslike. You know, she had a line there to cover, and she was pretty old then. God, she was in her 90s, I would say.
Well, she was 102 90. When she died.
Yeah, 102, yeah.
She was born in the year that Babe Ruth and the Red Sox went to the World Series for the second time when the Bambino was on the Red Sox. I think she was born in 1916, wasn't she?
Well, they were in the World Series that year, and they beat Brooklyn. The Red Sox beat Brooklyn.
How are you feeling?
I'm feeling much, much better. I was down. I was down and out for a while.
Now she
everything
was
going wrong.
Okay. Now she was the wife. I mean, she was the daughter of the Babe's second wife because his first marriage was rather unhappy. But he had a daughter with her, his first wife, didn't he, the Babe?
Yes, he did. Yes.
And the Babe was born a German Catholic in Baltimore, And he was raised in a Catholic orphanage, I believe, where he was taught baseball by one of the priests. So he was a devout Catholic, so he couldn't divorce his wife, but she had an untimely end because, she was living in sin in Boston and perished in a fire. And then the babe remarried, and his daughter, he had two daughters. Because Julie always said that she wasn't his stepdaughter, she was his daughter.
He had two daughters.
But, you know, knowing the babe, it could have, maybe it was his natural daughter, huh? Let's not get into that.
Yeah.
The babe was quite a carouser.
Oh, yeah. Loved his beer and his dogs.
The babe. And women. Ruth. You know, I was looking at the babe's, we were talking about him as a pitcher. Do you know that he only had two full seasons as a starter?
15 and 16. I think 18 also.
He in 15, he started 28 games. In 16, he led the American League with 40 games. 17, he started 38 games. But in 18, they were already putting him on the outfield. He only started 19 games. In 1919, his last year with the Red Sox, he started 15 games. So he won 89 games. He went 89 and 46 with the Red Sox. Twice a 20-game winner, 23 and 16, 24 victories in 17. And he won an ERA title in 1916. Even Barry Bonds on steroids couldn't have done that. But so he basically, he went 94 and 46. And in the Baseball Reference, has what's called the Hall of Fame monitor. So I was talking to you, and you think, how many games would he have won as a pitcher? 300, maybe even 400. So going down here, Hall of Fame statistics. Batting, 100. Batting 157. He's the highest ever recorded. The average Hall of Famer is 27. Pitching, he's a 10. And the average Hall of Fame pitcher is 40. So in just those few years, you know, that's only like basically 3 years he's a starter, and he's already a quarter of the way to the Hall of Fame, you know?
Yeah.
Listen to this. In batting, there's a thing called the Hall of Fame monitor. 415, that's what he scores, which is, you know, and the likely Hall of Famer is 100. So he's four times more valuable than your average Hall of Famer. But
that was Maddox?
No, we're back to hit batting.
Oh, I see. Okay.
You know, without the steroids era, with Balco making a Barry Bond go up like three hat sizes, his record is just so amazing, you know?
As a hitter. I know.
But he was before your time, wasn't he?
Who, Babe?
Yeah, you seem to have a... Unlike people like me, you know, I think the Babe's great, Joe DiMaggio. But
they're both great in their time.
You have ambivalent feelings about the...
Babe Ruth made baseball. Babe Ruth saved and made baseball.
Yeah. What was it, Casey Stengel? Casey Stengel the first person to hit a home run at the house that Ruth built?
Yeah, in the World Series.
And then he said that the babe hit a ball over his head. That was just, what was it, 500 some odd feet to center? That he never saw anybody hit a ball so hard, you know, because they were all harassing him on the Giants.
Yeah.
Just imagine, what would have, now Julia Steve's Ruth, the babe's daughter, said with the designated hitter, he'd have been able to play more. Because it was his knees that were killing him towards the end. And he retired at the age of 40. Whereas, when you look at Ted Williams at 42 was still hitting a ton, you know, What did he hit? 328 with 29. He just didn't like playing anymore. But what would the designated hitter have done for Babe Ruth?
Oh, my God. Many more games.
Yeah, but Babe wouldn't have wanted to be a DH, would he?
No, he would have fought it. No,
geez, even
he would have growled and said, I can play both fields, both sides of the field.
So did you hear about they're working on Aaron Judge's swing? And they say that he's going to have a fantastic season this year. Did you read about that?
No, I didn't. I lost a lot when I was in the hospital. I was in the hospital 16 days.
Holy smoke.
Then in rehab. And I didn't get the paper. The TV sucked. I didn't get the major league channel. So it was hard to keep up on stuff.
Yeah, I had a friend that was over at CMC at the same time. He couldn't even get Jeopardy. It was there, but it was kind of scrambled in his room. I mean,
yeah.
Can you imagine no Jeopardy and no baseball?
I know.
I guess they do that to get you out of the hospital and rehabbed.
Right. Right.
Hey, what do you think? You have heard about the three contracts that if you put them end to end, you could there are many metaphors, but they're almost $1 billion. What do you think about Bryce Harper getting 13 years?
$330 million. I don't see it. I just think that's way too much.
Why would the Phillies pay so much money?
I don't know. I know they're trying to win it this year, so are the Mets. Mets are the most improved team in that division. But we're just talking about. I'm getting Alzheimer's already.
You're in the club, huh?
Oh, Harper. Harper is. What did he hit last year? 158?
No, he hit 249. This is a guy that's only driven in 100 runs once. He drove in 99 the year he hit 42 dingers. That was his good year, 2015. He went 330, yeah. 42, 99. Oh, those are Mickey Mantle, Mickey hit 40 dingers and only 94 RBI. But, which is, a lot of people say the RBI is meaningless, which I think is not true. But that was his only good season, and he couldn't. I'm a big Nats fan. That was his MVP year. He didn't get them into the winning circle. He's only had MVP votes. Can you imagine? He's only had MVP votes 3 years. It's not like somebody like Barry Bonds every year, or Carl Yastrzemski, or Mickey Mantle. Every year, they're in the top five when they're at their prime.
Yeah.
And they're in the top
Mike Trout,
10.
Too, yeah.
Oh, Mike Trout, yeah. who would be worth $300 million.
He's there every year.
Yeah. Well,
he's
Mike
been
Trout
having a good year every year.
I mean, is his defense worth it? Because he's never won a Gold Glove, Bryce Harper. I've seen him play.
No, Bryce Harper, I don't think has won a Gold Glove.
He's never won a Gold Glove.
Mike Trout has.
He's never won a Gold Glove. He's been a Silver Slugger just once, the year that he won the MVP, which was 4 seasons ago. I don't understand giving somebody that type of contract unless they needed it for, their TV contract.
It'll come back to haunt them.
Are you glad that the Yankees didn't get Bryce Harper?
Yeah, I am, actually. Yeah, there would have been a cluster in the outfield. You've still got Judge and Stanton and the gentleman they got from Minnesota there.
And, of course,
switch hitter. He's good for 25, 30 round trippers, decent average. So I like that outfield. And then this kid, Clint Frazier, they're expecting big things of him. But I don't know how I'm going to juggle that outfield this year.
Well, I wouldn't,
I don't see Ellsbury playing one inning for them.
They still got Ellsbury on his 200 some odd million dollar contract. He's still there.
Two more years of it.
Aren't you guys lucky, huh?
Oh, God.
Now, what about Machado? Okay. Sorry, go ahead.
I called that one when it happened. I said that was the worst trade the Yanks could ever make.
He had one good year.
Signing, I said.
I mean,
God almighty.
Signing, well, signing a Johnny Damon for, what was it, the $13 million for 1 year, I think 1 year, maybe he had 2 years. But he only signed a short contract, and not for that great money, but that was a key signing, Johnny Damon, because you're not, right, remember what he brought to the team, and you didn't have this big exposure.
Right.
And he was a winner. Right. That kid played his heart out. A few more years, he might have been a Hall of Famer.
I know. I was hoping he'd hang on for a year and a half.
But he didn't.
Those 3,000 hits. He's about 28-something, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
But
and maybe he will come into the Hall of Fame now that Harold Baines made it. I'm rethinking that. How about Machado? Do you think he was worth 10 years, $300 million? And what will he do for the Padres?
No. Nobody's worth that anyway. They're just not worth it unless, you know, they win every damn game and they're the ones that knock in the winning run. That's not going to happen. It's just, I don't understand the mentality of the not the manager, but the general manager, GM. I just don't understand sometimes.
Now, how much How much? Go ahead. Who's our other $300 million man? Nolan Arenado. I don't even know how to pronounce his name. How much did he get?
Yeah, the catcher.
How much did he get? 260?
Something big.
Is a catcher? Something big. I can't see giving catcher big money with the way. You know, in the post-steroids era, you're not going to have a Pudge Rodriguez playing like he did for so long. Bench was through essentially as a catcher at the age of 33.
Yeah.
And the only reason Fisk could go into his old age, he didn't start catching till he's 27 because of military service and he came up late. He was a great basketball player at UNH, by the way.
Oh, at UNH?
Yeah. That was his sport, basketball. But he was 6'2 or 6'3.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll be darned.
So for our picks for the season, we're going to have to wait till next week, huh, Mr. Baseball?
Yeah. Yeah, I'll get my picks together. I'll feel 100% better.
Well, we'll have to do the American League first.
Okay.
Yeah. We can always tape off of site.
Yeah.
Babe Ruth's daughter. Well, that's the passing of an era, isn't it? Since he
sure came, is.
Since he came up in 1914. Now, was he owned by the Baltimore Orioles in the International League? Or am I thinking of Lefty Grove?
Yes, he was.
Did he play with the Orioles?
Sold to the Red Sox.
With Ernie Shore, right? They were sold as pitchers.
I didn't know Ernie Shore was sold with him.
I think Ernie Shore was sold with him. Now, what was Ernie Shore and the Babe's great connection?
You mean the time he came in and...
Yeah.
He relieved Ruth after he walked the guy and got kicked out of the game and then pitched for the next 26 outs. It was Ernie Shore.
Right, Babe Ruth went into the game, walked somebody, argued with the umpire, got thrown out, and Ernie Shore came in. The guy got thrown out, and he pitched 27 scoreless innings, didn't he? Well, 9 scoreless innings. But he didn't. They don't consider. He only pitched 26 outs, right? Because they don't consider the guy getting thrown out.
Right.
But and they took that away from him, didn't they?
Yeah.
Oh, you know, communism. Rampant.
They tricked them away from him.
Oh, when I move over there to... is my head still... There's just something about it, isn't it, Paul? The glow, the two balls.
You look like... kind of like Mickey Mouse.
Oh, if you could, if I could only, you could only come in and be on each side of my ear. Well, you'll be able to watch the replay, Mr. Baseball. You know, what else could we do? Just put Mr. Baseball like a big nimbus over my head and look like the baseball sun god. So, any last-minute observations, Mr. Baseball, about the greatest game ever?
Greatest game ever was, in my opinion, was the Bobby Thompson home run.
Well, that's before my time, but a novel actually begins with that, Underworld by Don DeLillo.
Oh, yeah.
And he was a...
I was 11 years old, and he came up with two outs in the ninth, and maybe two outs, I think. And he hit a three-run homer and won the game 5-4.
Is that when they had to play the three-game playoff?
Three-game playoff.
Was that a World Series game?
No, that was a three-game playoff. You're right, Dodgers and Giants.
Right, because the NL always did the three games. We did the one, and if it had been three, I still think the Red Sox would have lost in 78, but they might have won game 164. But that Yankee team of 78, it was destiny.
Yeah.
Just as it's destiny, folks, for the Red Sox to be the dynasty of this millennium, just like they were at the early part of the last century. We'll see you next week on Ward 13. Oh, this coat. And hopefully we'll have some other fantastic graphics for you and Mr. Baseball, too. Take care. Bye. Feel like Al Jolson.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'll talk to you in a few days.